It's Rafaela from Migraine Australia again. Now, a lot of people come into our Facebook group and get a bit overwhelmed. There's all these people that have been migraine warriors for decades talking about neuros and drugs and all these kinds of stuff. And what does that all mean? One of the questions we get asked a lot is, why would you go to a neurologist? So to answer that question, I've got Dr. Ron Granot. He's with East Neurology in Bondi Junction, a great neurologist, knows a lot about migraine. Thanks for joining us, Dr. Granot.
Pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
Really happy to talk to you. So we're going to start with the really basic stuff. Literally, what is a neurologist? What do they do?
So neurologists are basically specialist physicians that are focused on problems with brain, nerves, and muscles. And in this context, migraine is probably the most frequent condition that we have to deal with. I think almost every neurologist would have around 50% of all their patients for everything they see treating migraine.
Okay, so does every neurologist do stuff with migraine, or should we look for somebody who says they're interested in migraine?
That's a tricky question politically, but I've got to say, look, I've seen lots of patients for second and third and other opinions for the management of migraine. I'd say having experience in treating migraine is really important. It's not just about this drug works or that drug works. It's a lot about whole of person care. So you have to understand that migraine is not just a biological condition, but it's also has its both impacts and triggers, psychological and social problems. So you have to kind of understand the whole issue. Then you have to know and be able to tailor medications, both acute medications, to try and abort migraines and reduce disability, and also pick the right preventative for the right patient. And often I've got to say, in those second and third opinions, what I've found most useful is actually knowing very simple things like you have to try a drug that's tolerable. So you have to pick which one is most tolerable for that particular patient, and then persevere. In other words, try it at the right dose for the right length of time. If it doesn't work, and they often don't, you then have to switch and have to persevere again, this time until you find something that works. So, you know, I've had patients years ago who we went through, you know, 10 different medications. This particular one I'm thinking of was actually a work cover patient. And eventually I convinced work cover to subsidize Botox, and he's been headache free since.
Wow, that's fantastic. I actually came to you for a second opinion way back when in the day. It was a long time ago.
It was a while ago.
It is okay to go and get a second opinion, isn't it?
Absolutely. Look, I think from our perspective, everyone knows that you know, patients go and see other neurologists. We often know each other anyway, so I don't see a major issue with it. I mean, I'm happy, and often when I see a patient for a second opinion, I'll give them my opinion and say, you're most welcome to go back and see your own neurologist. These are the sorts of things I'd think about and do differently or the same. Let's keep going this way.
Fair enough.
And I think a lot of it is also about education. Mm. So a lot of the issue is taking control of the migraine and understanding what it is, what it does, how it affects you, so that you can sort of realize this is the effect it's having on my overall life, and then try and reverse that and take charge of it. I had patients who simply started a headache diary, and in so doing actually felt already a lot more in control of what they're doing. It's beginning to sort of take charge and move forward, as opposed to being powerless and controlled by the fear, which is one of the biggest things I find with patients, the fear of, is that next migraine coming soon? What will it do? Will I be somewhere where I can do anything about it? Do I have to rush home, leave work, leave the social outing, rush home and go to bed? Which to me is the worst of the worst. That's disability. You can't do what you want to do.
Absolutely. So does everybody with migraine need to see a neurologist at some point?
So from my perspective, there are a couple of things. One is the diagnosis correct? So if the GP is comfortable saying, look, this is very classic migraine and so on, then that should be okay. GPs will then be able to manage often a little bit. I see even on your website, you say that it's under-recognized and under-treated, which I can't argue with you. As I was saying before, I think I felt it my job to try and teach GPs as well to be aware that not only is it not just another headache, but it's something that has real impact on patients that has to be taken seriously and dealt with. If that sort of level of treatment isn't working, then you need to move forward and see a neurologist to get a plan and basically execute that plan and make it work so that the disability is reduced and ideally gotten rid of altogether.
Okay. You do need to be referred from a GP though, don't you?
In Australia, absolutely, to get a Medicare rebate. That's the way the system works.
Is it okay to research neurologists and then tell your GP which one you want to be referred to? Or should you just let your GP refer you to whoever they like?
Again, it depends on
tricky.
Your GP. Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, it depends on your GP. Most GPs, if you come in and say, I want to see this doctor, they'll say, sure, I'll refer you there. Some GPs will say, look, I know this particular doctor is very good. They'll suit you. And they have experience not only from reviews on the net, which are always hit and miss, I have to say, because the bulk of patients don't review their doctor. Some GPs will then know this neurologist has looked after patients like you and they were happy. And so maybe go to see who they recommended. But okay. I think both are fair and either way is reasonable. You can always go see, try, and if it doesn't work for you, try someone else.
How about we step out a bit more generally? Let's say you're working with a neuro for a while and whatever they're giving you isn't working. Is it okay to come back to your neuro and say, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to take this drug anymore or whatever it is.
Absolutely. What I was going to say is that there's an art and a science. So we know from a science perspective, we know that a selection of these sort of 15 medications work in a group of migraine sufferers. And they all have very similar response rates of about 50% of people who try it will get better on that particular medication. The art part is trying to pick medications that will have fewer problematic side effects for that particular patient, realizing what side effects are a problem and how to get through them. So for example, if you're too sleepy at night, take medication earlier, modify the doses, drop it down, increase it slowly and try and get to an effective dose. But if you're on a medication and you can't take it, and there are some, for example, that cause bad depression. If you have that side effect from a particular medication, it's pretty simple. You need to come off that medication. And, you know, there are plenty of other options to choose. It's just got to be done in the right way over the right time frame and dose. But absolutely, I think if you don't like a medication, it's not working out, or even if it is working, but the side effects are now becoming more of a problem, then it's a good reason to change.
That's really good information. So how often on average would a migraine patient need to see a neurologist?
Normally it's about every 2 to 3 months, but it depends on how well controlled you are or not. Particularly early on, we'd make it about 2 to 3 months to give a particular medication time to have an effect. So it usually takes a little while for the medication to build up in the system and then at least 4 to 6 weeks to see an effect. So I get patients to fill out their headache diaries and then see what happens in terms of a response to that particular medication. And if that doesn't work, then you move on to the next one. But while the talk with doctors is always about pills, 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 I think it's also important to say that you also should be thinking about triggers. What was good this month? What was bad that month? Why did this get better? And, you know, a lot of the time I have patients who only realize how much stress, for example, is playing a role when they go on a holiday, a relaxing holiday, and suddenly realize I had very few migraines, or took time off work and then said, you know, doing that, I had very few migraines. And I've had patients now with COVID sort of saying, I started working from home and it was just more organized and calmer and there weren't people annoying me and I had far fewer migraines. So then we say, okay, well, now what we need to do is apply that knowledge to real life and either modify work, see how you deal with it. So I had a patient, I think even 6 months ago, who I think had daily headaches, was talking to their boss and everything their boss said, he took it as a criticism. And essentially terrible headaches at that point, felt stressed and under pressure and being scrutinized all the time. And we talked about that and he came back next time. We changed medications and things too, but he came back next time and said, my boss is the same. My reaction to my boss isn't the same anymore. I'm a lot more relaxed about it and the headaches have gotten better. So You've got to look at everything. It's not just pills, pills, pills.
Yeah, you've got to look at the whole person and the whole body.
That's right. That's right.
Absolutely. That's really great. Do you have like a number one tip that you would give, particularly new people who've just been diagnosed with migraine, on how to manage their migraine care?
So I think firstly, keep a track of it. So often we're very good at forgetting unpleasant things. So you won't remember how many migraines you've had. You won't know how good or bad things are. So you just sweep it under the mental rug. So starting a headache diary is a great first step. And then the other thing to sort of be sure of is try and abort headaches as they come, as opposed to what I tell basically all my patients. The number one myth that I see among migraine sufferers is this one won't be a migraine. And they wait and they wait and they take the Panadol and then they wait some more and then drink some water. And, you know, my next question is, well, you wait and what happens? And almost invariably they say, then it turns into a migraine. So the answer is that you also have to sort of put away the denial and say, right, well, it's time for me to get treating this, take charge of it, try and control it early, when we know medications and other therapies work better taken early. And then if there's a lot of them, and, you know, usually I'd say more than 4 a month, then it's time to start thinking about more than just acute therapies and talk about preventatives.
Alrighty. Thank you so much for making the time.
Absolute pleasure.
And for your continued fighting and raising awareness of migraine. We really appreciate it.
No, absolute pleasure. And good luck with all, you know, really good work, I got to say. I was very impressed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Granot.
Pleasure.